People start saying, back at home, what are they going to say? The people, wallahi, are you really bothered to fulfill the amana of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you? If that is the case, watch out. Fulfill it in a beautiful way. If you have proper reasons, give them. MashaAllah, talk to your child. Don't use the fact, oh, you know, in our family it doesn't work like this. Do you not belong to Islam as a family? Are we not family members here? Are you not part of my family? I'm part of your family. We have the deen. We have Islam. Subhanallah. So, don't say, you know, in my family, my tribe, they don't allow it. You know, our culture, if your culture agrees with Islam, it's a beautiful culture. If there are two, three elements that are against Islam, you have to drop them because Islam comes first. I am saying that yes, there is an ideal. Every parent has some dream. But can I tell you that reality, whether you like it or not, you have to adjust your dream as the years pass. If you don't, you will be angry, you will be depressed. Many of us, when we were young, we had a dream. One day I will do this, one day I will do that, one day I will do this. And you had to change your dream. I'm sure you heard the story about the man who was, I said it in this masjid some time back, and I want to say it again. The man who was a porter, and he had a dream that one day I will carry the goods of someone who's wealthy, and I'll get some money and I'll do something. So what happened is, he was at the train station, and there was a man who came out of the train with some milk. Milk in a can, a big can. And he was a wealthy man. That time there was a shortage of milk, so to have milk is something big. So he said, can you carry this? This man says, yes, I will carry this for you. And he says, I will give you a nice amount of money, good amount of money for this. So that man took the can and he put it on top of his head. And he was walking, very happy. Today his dream is coming true. Why? Because I'm going to get a lot of money. And you know, they have a skill. The porters, if you have seen them, they put something on their head. They have a skill to put something on top without holding it. And they can even run, it won't fall. They can even run, it won't fall. Because they know, they are experts in their field. Subhanallah. This young man, he has this thing and he's walking. And that man says, look, whatever you do, don't drop the milk. He said, no, I won't. Don't worry, I won't. So he's walking. And as he's walking, he's thinking to himself, I'm going to get, say for example, $100 from this man, or $10, whatever it was. I will buy two chickens. From there, the chickens will lay eggs. When they lay eggs, I will start selling eggs. Then I will buy more chickens. Before I know it, I'm going to have a fowl run. And I will have many chickens, they will lay eggs, and I will also start selling the chickens themselves. So I will now be a person who sells chickens and eggs. And after some time, I will buy some sheep. And then I will have a little farm, and I will be able to grow. On one hand, I have my chickens, my eggs. The other hand, I will have sheep and perhaps goats. I might want to sell some of the milk of the goats, and I might end up selling the sheep, and I will open a butcher. I will be a butcher. And after some time, I'll buy a big piece of land, and I'm going to buy some cows. When I buy the cows, we will sell milk, we will sell cows, we will sell so many things. Wow, I will employ 200, 300 people and I will make sure that everything runs. And he is busy walking with this milk on his head and his plan. Beautiful plan. It's workable, isn't it? It can work if he works hard and Allah gives him acceptance. There are from amongst us, even maybe sitting here, people who started off with nothing and mashallah, today they have so much. You know that. So it's possible. So he has this dream, and then he says, then I will buy a building in the city center. I will buy, because now, when I make money, I can't just leave all my eggs in one basket. I will buy a building in the city center. And after that, I will buy another building, and I will give it on rent, and I will become one of the biggest businessmen in this whole land. Then I will go to the king to ask him for his daughter. Did you hear that? I will go to the king, because now they will know me. I will be a businessman, and I will be the biggest. I will then go to them and say, look, I want to marry your daughter. And as he is thinking this, he hit a rock and this thing here fell down. So when it fell down, the owner of the milk, he was so upset. He turned around and said, look, what did you do to my milk? I lost my milk. He says, wait, hang on, relax. You only lost your milk? I lost my chickens, I lost my goats, I lost my eggs, I lost everything. So many people lost their jobs. And at the same time, I even lost a wife. The point I'm raising is you have to adjust your dreams. Because you have a dream. It's not wrong to dream. Dream, please dream. But remember, it's Allah's plan. You will have to adjust. We have idea, oh, I have daughters. Inshallah, I will get them grow, you know, they will grow up, mashallah, under me. I will teach them. They will become hafidha of the Quran. They will this. Everyone has a dream. I want my child to become imam of the masjid, to learn Islam, to spread the deen. Everyone has a good dream. I want my child to do this, to do that. You know what? And then you say, I want my child to marry someone, inshallah, who's a really good person, and inshallah, they will have children. I will have grandchildren one day by the will of Allah, and whatever, whatever. It's exactly like this man who had his dreams with his, you know, can of milk at the top. If anything happens to that can, trust me, you have to adjust your dreams. But Allah will give you something not very far off. If you aim very high with your children, inshallah, at least you will get halfway there. But if you have no aim, where are you going to go? You have no aim. So I have met young people, I want to memorize the Quran. I want to memorize the Quran. Give me some advice. Memorizing the Quran is not easy. Yes, it's good that you have the intention. Start today. You might not finish everything and you might find it difficult. How many children started it and then after a little while they gave up, they found it very difficult. At least they have a link with the Quran. At least now you can read the Quran looking inside properly. Some parents, they say, I want my child to be hafid. They push the child, they force the child, they have a problem with the child, they start fighting with the child, and the child goes in and the child starts learning Quran and they memorize one juz and then they give up after a big fight. You don't realize that while I was trying to make my child a full hafid, at least now they can read the Quran very beautifully looking inside. That's a bonus. That's a bonus. Have you thought of it? But if you didn't even plan that, they wouldn't even have achieved this much. So life is filled with hardship, one after the other, tests. You have to adjust your dreams. You have, one day you will have a lot of wealth. The next day you will struggle because you will suffer a loss. You have to suffer a loss. It's Allah's promise. Because that verse that I was reading in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ, you know what He speaks about in there? بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. I will definitely test you. Some days you will be inflicted with fear. Khawf. Fear of what? All types of fear. You are scared. Look at the people in some of the lands around us. May Allah protect our lands. May Allah grant them ease and goodness. Innocent people. They were living. They had nothing. Nothing was happening. They weren't interfering with anybody. They had to run away. Their homes were destroyed. Everything happened. They found to be refugees all across the globe. What happened to them? Take a lesson. We are concerned. We want to see solution. We are Muslimin. We want a stop to all the fighting and killing. That's how it's supposed to be. That's what we make dua for. Sometimes there is confusion. We don't even understand what's going on. That's how much confusion there is. But the lesson to learn is, those people, a lot of them had more comfortable lives than you have today. Do you realize that? What happened? Allah says, we tested them. We tested them. They adapted. They went. They came. Those people who were living, who in air condition, those people who had beautiful beddings, they were found later on to be in camps of refugees where they don't even have a blanket. But they got used to it. Allah gifted them by allowing their bodies to adjust, by allowing their system to adjust. You have to adjust. If you don't, you get depressed. You become sick. You suffer a sickness, a mental disease, because you did not adjust. You have to adjust. When you lost your job or your salary went down or they were retrenching people and you had to go, for example, don't be depressed. Make the most of what you have. Some of the people who are the healthiest and wealthiest are from among those who one day they suffered a dip and then they came up. They suffered a dip and then they came up. I can give you a true story of a man who went to look for a job as a cleaner at one company in the United States. It's a true story. And he went for the interview, he had the interview, and this person asked him that, you know, what's your email? At the end of the interview, what's your email? He said, I don't have an email. He says, if you don't have an email, you are a nobody. You are a nobody. We cannot give you the job if you don't have the email. Anyway, he was disgruntled, upset. He walked out. As he went out, he saw some people selling tomatoes, you know. They call them tomatoes in America. Anyway, selling tomatoes on the road, and what happened is, He realized, hey, this is also a good way of earning money. So he went to the market, he brought some tomatoes, he bought some, he sold, and he bought a few more and he sold, and he became a person who sells vegetables. And in no time, mashallah, he started delivering one corner to the other with a little bit of a profit. And before, he bought a little stall and a little, you know, one of those, what do they call them? A simple stall, one of those little stalls. And he started selling from that, and he was going on, and it got to a time when he bought a corner store, and after that he became a big supplier, huge, and he became one of the biggest in vegetables. And one day he was invited to some main, you know, some company, huge, for some function, and he went there and he met that man. Which man? A man who told him, you are nobody, isn't it? And today he was somebody. And guess what? When they met, and he was so thankful, where he said, you know what? If I was given that job, I was just going to be still a cleaner in your office. Did you hear that? But because you did not give me the job, and you told me I'm a nobody, I walked out and I started a business. And today, without an email, I'm somebody. Subhanallah. So I want to show you, this is an example to tell you that, you know what, my brothers and sisters, when you are rejected somewhere, perhaps Allah wants you to do something big, but if you become depressed, you won't be able to see the opportunities Allah has placed in front of your nose. This man had to look to see the tomatoes, and he realized, hey, this is a good idea. If he was depressed, he wouldn't even notice those tomatoes. He wouldn't even notice. So many of us here, we can relate to what I'm saying, because you have a job today, tomorrow you don't have the job. It can happen. Don't let it depress you. I am here to tell you, Allah is in charge. Allah is in control. Did you not have beautiful days? Yes, you did. So thank Allah. And continue working. I'm not saying sit back and relax and become a person who's just sitting and watching. No. You have to actually go and try and work and do something that will help you in a beautiful way. And inshallah, in that way you will be able to grow. So life is filled with obstacles. One of those obstacles you will find is, as Allah makes mention of it. In fact, let me move through that verse one by one. He says, Al-Khawf wal-Ju'. Allah says, we will test you with hunger. Hunger. Sometimes you don't realize you have a lot of food today, and tomorrow you might not have it. And sometimes you have the food, but tomorrow you might not be able to eat it because of your health condition. Subhanallah. You know, I was speaking to some brothers a few days ago, and I was saying, when you are 20, you smell of perfume. When you are 30, you smell of itr. The difference is, it's a little bit murakkaz, it has a little bit of a different taste. You're now maturing a little bit, perhaps. I'm not saying it's wrong to use perfume, but I'm giving an example. When you are 40, it becomes oud, mashallah. You know, now you know what oud is all about. And now you can afford it, perhaps. And once you turn 50, you are smelling of Vicks. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah grant us ease. It's Allah's way. You had your days. You were young. MashaAllah, you did everything. But subhanAllah, the days moved and you continued. So the point I was raising is al-ju'. Sometimes when you are young, you can eat. You have chocolates and ice creams and everything. When you grow a little bit older, when you are 20, you are eating everything. When you are 30, so perhaps one or two things, you start slowing down. When you get to 40, you see it, you want it, you still can't eat it. When you get to 50, you can't even touch it. So sometimes, you have to think 20 times. I say, thank you so much, no, mashallah, you guys carry on. And in your heart, you desperately want to have it, but khalas, you can't. So what happened? Your health made you not eat certain things that you really liked. It shows you that in this dunya, Allah will tell you there are things you like. You cannot have all of them. When you get married, you have your wife. You can't have all the women. From the rose bush, you picked one. If you are lucky, you might have to pick one more or maybe another two more. You will stop at four. Let me not go further with that one, inshallah. But the bulk of us, subhanAllah, you were lucky, you're fortunate, you picked one. But you have the one in your hand and you keep on looking at the rest of them. Oh, this, you are like a person who has sugar diabetes. You know you cannot have these chocolates and sweets, but you just look at them all day. Come on, at least eat that which is healthy for you here. SubhanAllah. Man does it with everything. Very upset, very, you know, man wants all. But Allah says, in this world, every time there will be certain things, you cannot have them. One of the reasons is because Allah has kept Jannah. That's why. In Jannah, the miza, you know, the beauty of it, the difference of Jannah is that you will have what you want. There you are, you, there is no even age. You will be eating what you want, you have what you want. There is no restriction whatsoever. Whatever comes to your mind is yours. So if Allah gave you everything you wanted in this world, what was the point of creating Jannah? But Allah says, no, we won't give you. You see the cars, you find the cars. You can buy the latest car today. Wallahi, as you are driving it, you will see one later than that. It just shows you the dunya, when you run behind it, it has to run faster than you. You have an iPhone 7, you have ordered the new Tesla. You know the Tesla is the new, the car of the future. It's already there. You can order it, $35,000 inshallah. They will deliver it next year. But you order the car, it's amazing. But can I tell you something? When you get it, there will be so many others who have it and another model which is perhaps higher than that. And they will have a different brand which might even be better than that. Who knows? This is what it is. That's the dunya. That's the nature of the world. You know, I want to give you one beautiful example that you will relate to. Many years ago, when I was much younger, we used to have certain cars. From among those cars, there was a Mercedes that was known, it was 123 series. You can go and Google it and check it. 300D. Wow, that was like the car of the time. They used to advertise this vehicle, and I remember going into, I didn't afford it or anything, but going into the Mercedes, you know, showroom, and just to get the book, to look at it and say, hey, lovely, you know, it's your dream car, you know, the 300D. You know, people who are very, should I say, short-sighted, they make a dua to say, oh Allah, you know, this car here, ya Allah, you know, at least if I don't get in the dunya, then at least in Jannah, give me the car. Young people, you ask them, so what would you like in Jannah? I know, my own son one day he told me, I need a Bugatti in Jannah. And then I had to correct him. I asked the question because I want to correct him. I said, you know, Bugatti, by the time you grow old, you won't even want to see it. So today, if someone offered the same people who were making a dua that time for a 300D in the dunya, forget about the akhirah, they will say, I don't need it, I don't want it. You understand the point? So this is why we say Allah has kept the dunya such that when you run behind it, it runs faster than you. You will never be able to keep up with it. But you need to understand and realize that Allah puts hardships as a gift. Another gift regarding hardship is, it softens your heart. It makes you get close to Allah. You have hunger, you have fear. What do you do? Oh Allah, save me. You know, people talk about jinn, subhanAllah, and there are jinn around and people are worried because you start seeing this person. Learn what Islam says. It's not my topic today, but I can tell you something interesting. After Salatul Fajr, after Salatul Maghrib, we read what is called Mu'awwidhat. Why? To protect yourself. From what? From matters of the unseen, issues of Al-Ain, issues of jinn and so on. Why? Because there is an element of fear. Allah has blessed you. Read your Mu'awwidhat. Ask Allah's protection. Allah gave you something so that you are not affected. So that without that element, you wouldn't have read this dua. Do you know that? Without that element, you wouldn't have read it perhaps. And speaking about jinn, there were these children that also, you know, they fear the jinn. You might have heard me say this. I said it last year sometime and I repeated it once or twice. But I want to say it again. So how people fear jinn is very, very interesting, you know. Yet the jinn in reality fear man. You know that? It's only when you fear them, then they can come for you. But if you don't fear them, you fear Allah alone, they will not even harm you. So what happened is this jinn, the two boys are trying to convince each other about something they learnt in the madrasa. And what happened is, the boy is telling the other boy, look, you have to say Bismillah when you are drinking water. You have to say Bismillah when you are drinking water. So the boy says, look, it's just water. I know when I'm eating, I will say Bismillah. This is only water. So why? Convince me, tell me, explain to me. Give me a good reason why I need to say Bismillah before I drink this water. So he's trying to explain, you know, you have to say Bismillah because it's the hadith and because this. The boy says, no, I want to be convinced. He says, okay, I tell you. You have to say Bismillah because in water, there are three jinns. There are three jinns. That he's so worried. What do you mean three jinns? He says, yes, you better say Bismillah, Bismillah. So what are the jinns? Where are the jinns? He said, no, two hydrogen and one oxygen. H2O. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. But that's just a point to show you how people fear the jinn. So because of this khawf that you have, what happens, one of the points is it drives you closer to Allah. You make dua. Your health, for example, we fear that sometimes when you are not feeling well and you are going for a test, you have a major blood test or some scan or something, what do? You cry to Allah, "Oh Allah, help me. My test results must be clear, Ya Allah. Those who have been ill, may Allah grant them shifa. Those with cancer, may Allah grant them cure. Those with any type of disease and sickness, may Allah grant you cure, and all of us. And those who are healthy, may Allah keep you healthy." Ameen. So, this is part of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there will be times when you are fearful. And hunger, we spoke about hunger. And then Allah says, وَنَقْسِمْ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ. Beautiful. We will test you with loss of wealth and life. Loss of wealth and life. So all of us who are seated here, and everyone who's going to listen to this in the future also, I can tell you something. There will never be a single person who has not seen a loss in their life. Sometimes that loss doesn't mean it's going to take you underground and make you bankrupt. No. But if you were earning easily at some stage, there will come a time when that earning is not going to be the same. For Allah to test you, what are you going to do? Do you realize before we made you, we already told you what we're going to do to you? Before we made you, we told you we're going to test you. You have a beautiful job and suddenly it's no longer there. Or you have a beautiful job, beautiful salary, and suddenly they're cutting down on salaries. And you have to take a cut rather than an increase. All of us want increase, isn't it? Salaries, you want increase. And they tell you, look, you know what, either you take a cut or we can't afford you anymore. You have to make a big decision. Don't become depressed, turn to Allah. Read two raka'at of salah. Kana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam idha hazabahu amrun fazi'a ila salah. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was overcome by something, he used to quickly go to salah. Whenever there was something of concern, he used to read salah. And that salah used to help so much. You're getting closer to Allah, you are praying to Allah. So Allah says, we will test all of you with loss. You cannot make a profit every day. You cannot be on a good wicket every day. There will be loss. The deals, when you buy certain things, some of those things, there will be barakah in and some of them no barakah in. Sometimes you buy a car and it lasts for 10 years and it's still like new. And sometimes you buy a car and the first year it's already damaged and broken and it's like a waste. Well, that was from Allah. He tested you. So long as you are not reckless, so long as you try to look after the ni'mah of Allah, you need to now move on. You need to thank Allah and carry, do something about it. The situation that you are in, don't dig a hole in the ground and start becoming depressed. Thank Allah, no matter what it is. That's why on the day of judgment, those going to Jannah, one of the categories, a caller will call, أَيْنَ الَّذِينَ كَانُوا يَحْمَدُونَ اللَّهَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ. And they will be granted Jannah. Where are those who used to praise Allah at times of ease and at times of goodness? They used to say, Alhamdulillah, come, we want to give you Jannah. Imagine, Allah is telling you, those who used to thank me when they were in hardship, I want to give them Jannah. Because they're thanking me, at least I gave them something. Compare yourself with someone worse than you, you still have a gift. So my brothers and sisters, when something negative happens to you, you say, Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. I praise Allah on all conditions. A'udhu billahi min hali ahli an-nar. Only I seek Allah's protection from the condition of those who are in the fire, the people of the fire. So learn to thank Allah. Alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. And then Allah says, we will test you with loss of life. What is the meaning of loss of life? Subhanallah. Your parents, your children, your siblings, your friends, and those who you know, those who are close to you, we will take them away. Either we will take you before them or them before you, or we take all of you together. That's a test. You came in this world, what's the next step? Before I came here, I was somewhere. Then I came here, and after this, I need to go somewhere. Isn't it? This is a short period of time. Everyone's time is different. Allah says, we will test you by taking life away. So the life will go. It has to go. You have no option. Your father has to die. You have to die. Your child has to die. Someone has to die. We only don't know the timing. And we don't know how. So what do you do? Yes, you will cry. The Prophet ﷺ lost his son Ibrahim. And he was carrying him and he was crying. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum looking at the tears of Rasulullah ﷺ. And you know what? He made the beautiful statement. He says, when they asked about the tears, he says, إِنَّمَا هِيَ رَحْمَةٌ جَعَلَهَا اللَّهُ فِي عِبَادِهِ الرُّحَمَةِ. He says, I'm not questioning the decree of Allah. These tears are the tears of rahmah. They are tears of mercy. Allah has put in the hearts of those who have mercy. It's normal to cry. It's normal to be saddened at a loss. But it's not the sign of a mu'min to become depressed at a loss. That's the difference. Don't become depressed. Don't play the blame game. Blame game meaning, if I did this, maybe my child would have this, or my brother would have this, if I did this, that. All those ifs, taftahu baba shaytan. According to the hadith, law. When you say law this, law that, maybe this, if that, if this, it opens the door of the devil. That's what the hadith said. The devil will tamper with your mind, destroy your relations, everything gone. Don't do that. Thank Allah. Alhamdulillah. Oh Allah, help me. Allahumma ajirni fi musibati. Wakhluf li khayran minha. Oh Allah, you are asking Allah's help to grant you out of that musibah and difficulty that you have. Help you through it, save you from the calamity, and at the same time give me something better in return, oh Allah. That's what you are saying. So it's an amazing gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, life will be full of hardship. Like I say, you will lose your children or your spouse. If you are married and you really love your wife or your husband, you have to tell yourself, one day they're going to go, or I'm going to go, or we're going to go together. You have to. There's no two ways. Don't let that depress you, because that's life. That is life. You look at your children, it is normal to think that, you know what, let me use this, let me thank Allah for this goodness as it is here. I may not have my children soon. It's normal to think that. But it's not normal to become depressed at that, because that is part of the test of Allah. When you go to school, it's normal to be tested. You don't see the question and you just sit back with your pen down and you are depressed and you are crying. Hard question. The question is so difficult. And you are crying. While you are sitting in the exam room, try, attempt it, do something, say something, use whatever you've learned, check, write some form of an answer, anything, you know, whatever you want to write, try, and inshallah, perhaps you might have struck it. But if you didn't try, you put your pen down and you started crying, you definitely failed. There was no question about it. There was no question about it. So this is why we say, my brothers and sisters, look at the Quran. See that Allah says He will test you. From the point of birth you are tested, and you will be tested all the way to the point of death. Even the sickness right at the end, when people are terminally ill, a powerful piece of advice: you die with hope in Allah. أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي. Allah says, I will treat each of my worshippers according to the way they perceive me. So if you think, inshallah, is Ghafoorul Rahim, I have committed sins, Allah will forgive me, I made tawbah, I tried my best, ya Allah, Raufur Rahim, Ghafoorul Rahim, Rahmanun Rahim, forgive me, have mercy on me, I have no option but to return to you. You are the one. When I was younger, I had energies, I committed so many sins, ya Allah, you know, right now, I have nothing besides you, I'm going to return to you, ya Allah, I know that you will forgive me, because I'm asking you for this forgiveness, and you die with a smile. Subhanallah. Don't become depressed. People are terminally ill, they become depressed. Even if you hold the chair very hard, you will still die. Doesn't help you. No matter what, you will still die. So when a person is terminally ill and they are old, remind them of their good deeds. It's a sunnah. Remind them of their good deeds. Remind them of the mercy of Allah. Have good words on your tongue. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all ease through the difficulties that we will face. We have faced. We are facing. Every one of us here, I'm sure we are facing difficulty, we are facing hardship of some nature. Some are more than others. Some people have bigger problems than others. Some people have smaller problems than others, but because they don't know how to deal with it, they think that it's the biggest problem on earth, not realizing that so many other people have been through those problems. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. May Allah open your doors. May Allah open the doors of every one of us of mercy. May Allah grant you sustenance and good health. And more than anything, may Allah make us closer to Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us as close as possible to Him. Wallahi, my brothers and sisters, when you go through difficulty, it's a gift of Allah. You become closer to Allah. You come to salah. You come to tahajjud. You come to dua. Your heart is softened. You become a better person. You start dressing with hijab. You start doing things for the sake of Allah. You realize that life is not all about partying, and it's not all about wasting of money. My brothers and sisters, learn to save a little bit. Learn learn to reach out to other people. When you help other people, Allah will help you. So inshallah, in this way, we will be able to get closer and closer to Allah. I hope that the few words I have said will be of benefit to myself to begin with, and then to the rest of us. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد. سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.